Cresthill Church, let me be the first to welcome you here today. We're so glad you decided to join us. Make sure you share this service with all of your friends by clicking the share arrow at the bottom right-hand side of your screen on Facebook so that all your friends know the amazing stuff we're doing here at Cresthill. If this is your first time joining us, make sure you say hi in the chat so that we can welcome you and so that we know you're here. We know you're not here by mistake and that you clicked on this worship service today for a reason. So wherever you are, in the kitchen, in the living room, even in your PJs in the bedroom, or at Cresthill, let's worship together.
Let's worship together.
Let's worship.
Let's worship together.
Let's worship.
Let's worship together.
Let's worship together.
Let's worship together.
Let's worship.
Let's worship together.
Oh,
Just get still in His presence right now. Giving us the opportunity to talk to you and to hear from you of your love for us. We're so aware of your presence in this place today, and we're so grateful for it, God. You are higher than any other God. You are the only true God. We worship you. We thank you for what you did, Jesus. Understand. So we say hallelujah. We praise you, Father. We say hosanna. God save. And we say maranatha. God come. Come soon.
Joy to honor you in all I do. Everybody repeat, Lord, you are good, and your mercy endureth forever. All right, you ready for the next one?
Morning, church. So good to be together and to realize the privilege that we have just this time right now to be able to together come before the Lord our God. And He's listening. He's there to receive our worship and our prayers right now. So let's do that together. Join me as we pray to our Father. Heavenly Father, it is so good to be back together again, worshiping you, praising your name, to declaring how good you are. Lord, thank you for bringing this family together, the family of God here at Cresthill Church. And Lord, we're here together on campus in the building, but we're also gathered together online through different ways, through different electronic venues. We're all together, worshiping you together as your church. Father God, we thank you for meeting us here, to being with us, to making your presence known, letting us know through your presence that you love us. Lord, we feel your love. And Father, we know that you care for us. So we just come and we say thank you. Thank you that we can come and know that you are the Shekinah glory, the presence here with us, your dear loving presence, that kind of glory just invades us when we come and worship you. We feel a presence that never leaves nor forsakes. And Father God, the days can be full of highs and lows, and they certainly are. We can experience both joys and struggles. There's days of abundance and moments of need. But through it all and in it all, you are there. The Spirit is there through and through, both in us and around us. And it gives us strength to move ahead, to make it through, but not just that, Lord, but to really make pathways and opportunities for the power and majesty of your name to be manifested through our circumstances, through our lives, so that we can just step aside and let you be God. We don't need to try to fix the mess that might be there. We just lift our hands and surrender and give it to you, whatever that might be. We just hand it over to you, God. So when we see you move, we praise your name and we give you all the praise. And when we have to wait, and Lord knows I don't like to wait, I still give you the praise. And Lord, even when I doubt and wonder, even when there seems to be silence, I still give you the praise. So in all things, Lord, we humble ourselves before you because you are our God. And you're the King of kings and you're the Lord of all. And that includes being the Lord of all of me. All of us, you're the Lord of my life, my world, all my things, my stuff, my health, my family, my job, my finances or lack therein, my car, the gas I have to put in it. Lord, everything, Lord, you're the Lord of it all. So I lay it before you, Lord. I just give it all to you. So, Lord, now we just come to pray and we talk to you as our Father. We worship you and we praise you. And we admit the sin that's there, and we confess our transgressions, and we intercede on behalf of others, Lord. We pray for others. And Lord, we come in prayer and we share our passions and desires, and we cry out on behalf of our needs, and we know that you're there and you hear our prayers. And Lord, we declare right now at this moment of prayer that you are enough. Lord, you are Jehovah Jireh. You are enough. You are all we need. You fill us up. You give us purpose and meaning. You give us our identity. And so now we can just come right now and just sit with you a while, just like we can any time, any day. We sit at your presence. We talk to you. We can be open and honest with you in our times of intimate prayer, that you are actually allowing us to talk to you and that you are actually there and you actually listen, God. We thank you and praise you. So now, God, just open our hearts and our minds. Shape us some as we listen to the words of our shepherd, our pastor, as we hear your Holy Spirit speaking through him to us. So in the name of Jesus, we lift up these prayers to you, Father God. Amen.
Good morning. God has a word for us today. But right now, we're going to give God a word of praise. I want to teach you a phrase or a word, depending on how you break it down, that you may not know. It's called praise break. Say that with me. Praise break. I feel the Holy Ghost up in here. How about you? Amen. And so let us take just about 30 seconds. If you get jacked up and want to do it longer, nobody's going to stop you. Would you rise to your feet, both here in this room and those of you that are with us around the globe, a part of our global congregation online, and would you just take 30 seconds and just break loose and give God some praise up in here? Come on, just praise him. Yeah. Yeah. Amen. Amen. Yes. Praise God. Listen, if you got breath in your lungs, you got blood in your veins, you got a roof over your head, even if you don't, give him some praise up in here. Praise him. Let the folks around the globe know that Cresthill praises the Lord. Yes. Uh-huh. Yes. Oh, the devil's gonna get it today. Glory to God. Give three people a high five and have a seat there. Go ahead. Come on. Slap somebody and have a seat there. Yeah. Oh, praise him again. Go ahead. Go ahead. Yeah. And if you're praising at home like we're praising in here, your neighbors probably think you're crazy, but that's all right. That's all right. Amen. Everybody's somebody's fool, said St. Francis of Assisi. The question is, whose fool are you? Amen. We are fools for God. Give him some praise again. Come on. Yeah. Oh, give him some praise again. Yeah. Yeah. Amen. Amen. Praise God. Amen. Praise God. Yes. Amen. Yes. Amen. Thank you, sir. All right. Yeah. Listen, as long as the Holy Ghost is on a roll, I'm not going to interrupt, you know. Amen. Praise God. There you go. Praise God. This is good. I want to share with you this morning, real quickly here, I want to talk with you this morning about the word prayer. Prayer is the most basic but most neglected characteristic of a Christian. Maybe it's because we're too busy. maybe, just maybe, it's because we're too independent. Or perhaps maybe it's because we really don't know how to pray. So for whatever reason, you don't pray or don't pray as you wish you prayed, today we're going to fix all of that. Today we will begin a journey exploring 21 prayers in the Bible that will inspire us to pray. So let the journey begin. Let's take a look at prayer number one. Exodus chapter 17, verses 8 through 16. The three prayers that we're going to explore today all come from the second book of the Bible, the book of Exodus. The book of Exodus narrates the story of how the Israelites left slavery under bondage in Egypt. The book of Exodus details the events that led up to their miraculous deliverance as well as their journey to the promised land. It is here that we begin our journey into understanding what prayer is and how to pray. Exodus chapter 17, verses 8 through 16 in the Message version of the Bible says, Amalek came and fought Israel at Rephidim. Moses ordered Joshua, select some men for us and go out and fight Amalek. Joshua did what Moses ordered in order to fight Amalek. And Moses, Aaron, and Hur went up to the top of the hill. It turned out that whenever Moses raised his hands, Israel was winning. But whenever he lowered his hands, Amalek was winning. But Moses' hands got tired, so they got a stone and they set it under him. He sat on it, and Aaron and Hur held up his hands, one on each side. So his hands remained steady until the sun went down. Now here's the rest of the story. Joshua defeated Amalek and its army in battle. God said to Moses, write this up as a reminder to Joshua to keep it before him. Now remember, Joshua is the commander of the troops of God. Because I will most certainly, says God, wipe the very memory of Amalek off the face of the earth. Moses built an altar and named it God My Banner. He said, salute God's rule. God at war with Amalek always and forever. This passage teaches us that the battle between Israel and the Amalekites was fought as much in prayer as it was with soldiers engaged in battle. Moses, here's the story. Let's break this down. Moses goes to the top of a hill that oversees the battlefield to intercede in prayer while the army of Israel battles down below. And as long as the hands of Moses are raised up in the air, the children of God are winning. But when his hands got tired and he waned in prayer, the battle surged in the direction of the Amalekites. Here we see a great picture of Aaron and Hur supporting Moses' arms, keeping them lifted up in prayer over the battle, supporting both Moses and the troops to press on in this long, weary, exhausting battle, win the day, and take the land. Great story, right? Hello? Great story, right? But do we have evidence, any evidence in more recent history of somebody's prayers determining the outcome of a war? Yes, we do. John Knox was a great man of God. John Knox was a pastor, theologian, and founder of the Presbyterian Church. John Knox was a leader of the Protestant Reformation in Scotland. And John Knox was one of the greatest prayer warriors to ever live. John Knox was imprisoned in Lochleven Castle for his preaching. John Knox condemned Mary, Queen of Scots, as an adulteress and a murderer. And for the rest of his life, John Knox spoke of Mary, Queen of Scots, as that wicked woman. From the prison cell of John Knox, Queen Mary could hear him praying down the hall, God, give me Scotland or I die. Give me Scotland or I die. Mary, Queen of Scots, famously said, I fear the prayers of John Knox more than all of the assembled armies of Europe. Here's the rest of that story. Mary was imprisoned for her role in the murder of her husband, Lord Darnley. King James VI was enthroned to take her place. John Knox continued to openly call for Mary's execution. Mary was found guilty of plotting, get this, to assassinate Queen Elizabeth I of England. And Mary, Queen of Scots, was beheaded on February 8th of 1587. And John Knox was freed from prison, preached until the day he died. And his prayers moved a nation, moved a world, and moved eternity. I tell you all of that to tell you this. We can learn not only how to pray, but also be inspired to pray when we hear about a man like John Knox who followed the example of Moses. Hear me, please. We too can move this nation. Well, that was about 12 of you. We too can move this nation. We too can move this world. We too can move eternity when we pray for the army of God to take Satan's territory, take back what the devil stole from us, intercede with Holy Ghost confidence, move both the hand and the will of God in our situation and in the situations of others, and speed up that day when thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven comes to pass. That's what happens when we pray prayer number one. Would you like to take a look at another prayer? Amen. Prayer number two, Exodus chapter 32, verses 11 through 14. Exodus 32, verses 11 through 14. One of the greatest intercessory prayers in all the Bible is found in this passage. Here we see Moses interceding for the people of Israel. Do you know what that word intercede means? It means when you go before God on behalf of somebody else. Exodus chapter 32, verses 11 through 14 in the New Century Version says, but Moses begged the Lord his God and said, Lord, don't let your anger destroy your people, whom you brought out of Egypt with your great power and strength. Don't let the people of Egypt say, the Lord brought the Israelites out of Egypt for an evil purpose. He planned to kill them in the mountains and destroy them for the earth. So stop being angry and don't destroy your people. Remember the men who served you, Abraham, Isaac, and Israel. You promised with an oath to them and said, I will make your descendants as many as the stars in the sky. I will give your descendants all this land that I have promised them, and it will be theirs forever. So the Lord changed his mind and did not destroy the people as he said he might. God is angry, we see in this passage. God is ready to destroy his people. But Moses pleads to God not to do that. Moses appeals to God's character, watch this, as a promise keeper. Moses appeals to God's reputation before the unbelieving nations surrounding Israel. And the result of this intercession, this prayer that Moses makes on behalf of the people of God, we see in verse 14 of Exodus chapter 32, where it says, the Lord changed his mind and did not destroy the people as he said he might. The Lord changed his mind? What? God's purpose all along was to bless and not destroy his people. That was his will, and God's will did not change. What changed? Watch this now. What changed was Moses. What changed was Moses, who interceded, who prayed on behalf of the people of God. You see, God was waiting for somebody to stand in the gap. God was waiting for somebody to step up and step out and stand in the gap and pray for the people of God. Moses did that, and the Bible says Israel was saved from the evil results of their disobedience to God. Let me break that down for you. That's called mercy. That's called grace. That's called favor. That is called prayer. John Wesley was one of the greatest preachers to ever live. John Wesley was one of the greatest evangelists to ever live. John Wesley, the founder of the Methodist Church, was one of the greatest prayer warriors to ever live. John Wesley prayed 2 hours every day of his life. Because of the prayers of John Wesley, revival came to England, sparing them of the horrors of the French Revolution. George Whitefield was one of the greatest preachers to ever live. George Whitefield was also one of the greatest evangelists to ever live. George Whitefield preached at least 18,000 times to perhaps 10 million listeners in both Great Britain and the American colonies. George Whitefield was the hand of God in what historians call the Great Awakening. When during the colonial period of this nation, a great revival went across this nation and across Great Britain as well. A Holy Ghost revival that swept the nation. George Whitefield was one of the greatest prayer warriors to ever walk this earth. George Whitefield prayed 3 hours a day, 1 hour in the morning, 1 hour at noon, and 1 hour in the evening. And I believe that because of the prayers of George Whitefield, many, many, many souls were saved. I believe because of the prayers of George Whitefield, many, many churches were planted and started. And I believe because of the prayers of George Whitefield, this move of God propelled the American colonies toward their freedom. Now, I tell you all of that to tell you this. We can not only learn how to pray, but also be inspired to pray when we follow the examples of John Wesley, when we follow the example of George Whitefield, both of them who followed the example of Moses in Exodus 32, 11 through 14. We too can move the hand of God to bring revival to America. We can move the hand of God to bring revival to this nation before it's too late. We too can move the hand of God to bring this nation to Christ and bring the gospel to every single person on this planet. We too can change the course of America and change the trajectory of this world when we consistently, constantly, and concisely intercede with our Heavenly Father, not to destroy the people who populate this planet, but rather save them, set them apart, and launch them toward their God-appointed destiny. That's what we can do when we pray. Yes, we can when we pray. That's what happens when we pray prayer number two, and that brings us to the third prayer we're going to explore today. The third prayer from God's word. Prayer number three, Exodus chapter 33, verses 12 through 23. Exodus chapter 33, verses 12 through 23. Moses cries out to God. Can I teach for a moment? It is one thing to pray a prayer. It is another thing to cry a prayer. Have any of you ever cried a prayer to God? Your heart is so heavy, it is collapsing under the weight you are carrying, be it your own or somebody else's. Anybody in here carrying a burden? carrying a burden for somebody else, burden for a situation. Anybody online there, wherever you are around the globe, do you have a burden on your heart that God has placed there? It's so heavy sometimes it feels like it will crush the life out of you. You look around at your situation and it seems seemingly impossible. And it's at times like that that you do not say, "Let us pray." It's at times like that that you collapse. It's not because you entered into some pious posture of prayer, but you just can't stand up. Have you ever had your legs go out from under you because of the weight you're carrying? And sometimes your knees won't even do it. And if you're like me, sometimes you just got to fall straight out before God, prostrate. And you got to just stretch out your hands to God and say, "Lord, here I am in subjection to you. Dear God, breakthrough. Dear God." And sometimes all you can do is cry. And the hot tears cascade down your cheeks. And you can barely articulate the weight. That's a cry to God. I submit to you, we need some folks crying to God in prayer. Moses cried out to God. Moses cried out to God here in Exodus chapter 33, verses 12 through 23. Moses pleads with God to teach him his ways. Can I break this down for you? He's desperate. We just sang a couple of moments ago, "I'm desperate for you." Was that just a song we sang? Or was that the desire of your heart? "I'm desperate for you." Sing that with me. "I'm desperate for you." I'll sing it again. "I'm desperate for you." Let this be your cry. I got to teach you something here. "I'm desperate for you." Lift your hands to God and come on. "I'm desperate for you." Sing it again.
"I'm desperate for you."
That's got to be your cry. Moses was desperate for God to teach him his ways. Moses was desperate for God to ensure his presence. I don't know about you. I cannot make it without the presence of God. I tried, it don't work. And I'm here to inform somebody it will not work for you either. Nobody ever has. Nobody ever will. You're not going to be the first to walk the Christian walk without the presence of Christ. And if you want that abundant life, you got to cry out to God in desperation for his presence to be thick, my God. His presence to be heavy. His presence to be upon you. To have on you what you, I feel the Holy Ghost, to have on you what you got in you. Presence. I have learned to begin to speak in plural pronouns. Not "I'm going to," but "we're going to." Me and the Holy Ghost. We're going to. Say that with me. We're going to. We're going to. We're going to do this. We're going to do that. Say it again. We're going to. I don't know about you. I ain't going no place without God. Not one step. Don't you either. He cries out to God to teach him his ways, ensure his presence, and for God to show him his glory. His glory. His Shekinah glory. His shiningness, who he is, high and lifted up. Do you cry out for God to show himself to you that way? Show me your glory. Now, I want to tell you something. Be careful what you pray for. I read about this same Moses that cries out, and God walks by and he says, "You can't see my face, but I'll show you my back. Because if you see my face, you won't be able to take it." I believe that he would have melted in the light and the heat of his presence. That's why I love Jesus so much. John Claypool said that Jesus put a face on God so we could see him and love him and follow him. And then to receive Jesus and now to have that Shekinah, that glory within. When was the last time you cried out to God, "Show me your glory"? Show up. Show off. Let me see you. Even if everybody else is blind to you, Lord, would you just peel back? Would you just peel back the curtain of heaven just long enough to let me see you? Would you radiate into my situation? Would you enlighten and show up? Dear God, show me your glory. Say that with me. Dear God, show me your glory. Show me your glory. Show me your glory. But be careful. Sometimes it may be more than you can take. I was preaching in the streets of Somatillo. And he did. And some of y'all were there. And it took me out. And I was gone. And I got to see some things that changed me forever. And some of you brought me back, and I was madder than I've ever been at y'all. I was angry for a long time, Mark. Pulled my behind out of that street, brought me back into the land of the living. But I wouldn't take that back for anything. I want to say this with total clarity. I have absolutely no fear of death whatsoever. Because I've seen the other side. I've seen the other side. Show me your glory. Cry out to God. Exodus chapter 33, verses 12 through 23 in the Message version says, Moses said to God, "Look, you tell me lead this people, but you don't let me know whom you're going to send with me." Do you see the weight on him? Can you hear it? You ever had God tell you to do something that you knew that you were totally unqualified to do? Ladies and gentlemen, members and honored guests, I give you example A. You tell me, "I know you well and you are special to me. If I am so special to you, let me in on your plans. That way I will continue being special to you. Don't forget, this is your people, your responsibility." Now stop there. Can we go back to that last slide just for a second? Now, before you get all hacked off at Moses, he's right. He's right. There are some of you that are carrying burdens that you were never designed to carry. You are not equipped to carry them. God never wanted you to carry that weight around. It's his responsibility. So the Bible says, "Cast your cares upon the Lord because he cares for you." Psalm 55, verse 12. Give it to him. He's designed to carry it. Don't forget, this is your people and your responsibility. Back up just one second. I'm going to intercede this, and I hope you take this in the spirit. I'm going to offer it. Have you been pouring your life into somebody and they still haven't straightened up? You pray, you pour, you pray, you pour. I heard T.D. Jakes say this once, and I'm going to clean it up a little bit. If God can't fix them, why in the heck do you think you can? You can make heck whatever you word you want. I love y'all, but that's what I do. Don't forget, this is your people, your responsibility. God said, I'll go on now, I promise. God said, my presence will go with you. I'll see the journey to the end. Moses said, if your presence doesn't take the lead here, call this trip off right now. I wish I had some time. Make sure when you make your plans, God's with you. And if he's not, call the trip off. Whatever your trip may be. If your presence doesn't take the lead here, call the trip off right now. How else will it be known that you're with me in this, with me and your people? Are you traveling with us or not? Can I just stop here? A lot of us, when we pray, if I can teach for a second here, we believe that we have to, what is the King James term? We have to wax eloquently. That somehow the repetition of saying things will make it happen. Or that somehow if we use just the right King James phraseology, it will come to pass. Now, nothing wrong with the King James. I love the King James Bible. Those are the verses that I've memorized. So when a scripture comes to my mind, it comes to me in the KJV. I'm just telling you, that's how it works. But if we're going to be honest, if we're going to really pray, we got to start telling the truth. We got to start talking to God who already knows the truth. He already knows what's on our heart. If you were to pray with me, you would think that my prayers were irreverent. You would say, don't pray for that. That's not the right thing to pray. I pray for everything. I'm not going to show you my prayer journal, but I pray for everything. I mean everything. I don't leave nothing out. Right? And we just have to talk to God. When I first went to Southwestern Seminary, I went into the men's room there my first week on campus, and there's such a thing called bathroom graffiti. Do you know what I'm talking about? And it's in seminaries too, I hate to tell you. And Dick, hold on, it'll be all right. Dick's going to seminary, so hold on, brother, it's going to be okay. Two weeks he's going. But on the bathroom wall in the men's stall in the bathroom, the Southwestern Seminary, was etched this. And Jesus looked into his disciples and asked, who is it that men say that I am? And Peter responded, thou art the eschatological fulfillment of being. And Jesus looked unto Peter and said, huh? Just talk to him. That's what Moses is doing here. Are you traveling with us or not? How else will we know that we're special? I and your people among all the other people on this planet Earth. God said to Moses, all right. Did you see that? You need to pray until you get to the all right. You got to pray till you get to the all right. That's why you got to pray through. You got to proceed in your prayers. A lot of us stop short. You got to proceed in your prayer. Now, the answer may be no. Maybe wait. A lot of times it's yes. if you're praying God's will, according to God's word. But you got to pray until you get to the all right. I don't say many profound things, but I hope and pray that's one of them. God said to Moses, all right, just as you say, this also I will do, for I know you well. Yes, he did. I know you, he knows you too. For I know you well, and you are special to me. Do not forget that. Did any of you know, any of you ever looked at the resume of Moses? Humble beginnings, retrieved out of the river. Pharaoh's daughter, raised in the palace. Murders a guy. Tries to cover it up. Bible says he buried him in the sand. Guy found out. So he runs. So let me get this straight. He's a murderer. And he's a fugitive. And he runs away from God. And God still comes and calls him to do the miraculous. Let me tell you something. None of you are disqualified from serving Jesus. None of you. Don't you let the devil take you out of God's service. Don't you listen to him when he says, well, you did this and you did that. You tell him, shut up. I mean, literally, open your mouth and say, shut up. And talk to him and say, get away from me. Go back to hell. Oh, hey, before you go, I'm coming for you. You may go, but I'm on your heels. And you only get to go because I let you. For I know you well, and you are special to me. I know you by name. Moses said, please, let me see your glory. God said, I will make my goodness pass right in front of you. I'll call out the name God right before you. I'll treat well whomever I want to treat well, and I'll be kind to whomever I want to be kind. Quick time out. You pray, it's still God's will. God is still in charge. We don't tell God what to do. Right? We ask, we come boldly, we claim his promises, but we're not God. Make sure you recognize that when you pray. He is not your errand boy. Well, God, I got to be here on Tuesday at 10, and I got to be here Wednesday at 3, and I want you to do this. He is not your errand boy. God is reminding Moses of this here. I'll treat well whomever I want to treat well, and I'll be kind to whomever I want to be kind. God continued, but you may not see my face. No one can see me and live. This is what I was talking about a minute ago. God said, look, here's a place right beside me. Put yourself in this rock. When my glory passes by, I'll put you in the cleft of the rock and cover you with my hand until I pass by. Then I'll take my hand away and you'll see my back, but you won't see my face. Moses knows fully well that without God's presence, he cannot lead God's people into the promised land. Everything hinges on the presence of God. Recently, I discovered an article entitled Encountering God's Presence Through the Receiving of His Presence. Now, the thing that I loved most about this article was that it provided a guided prayer for experiencing the presence of God. This prayer has three steps. May I give these to you? Is that all right? Step number one, meditate on the nearness of God's presence. Meditate on the nearness of God's presence. Allow Scripture to fill you with the desire and faith to encounter God today. Psalm 139, verses 7 through 12 says, where can I go? This is David praying. Where can I go from your spirit? Where can I flee from your presence? If I go up to the heavens, you are there. If I make my bed in the depths, you are there. If I rise on the wings of the dawn, if I settle on the far side of the sea, even there your hand will guide me. Your right hand will hold me fast. If I say, surely the darkness will hide me and the light will become night around me, even the darkness will not be dark to you. The night will shine like the day, for darkness is as light to you. So step number one, say this with me, meditate on the nearness of God's presence. Step number two, take a minute to quiet your heart and mind. Take a minute to quiet your heart and mind. Ask the Holy Spirit to help you receive God's presence. Take note of any desires that you have as to whether you should sit quietly, whether you should worship Him, whether you should read, be it the Bible, be it a devotional, be it a spiritual biography, be it a work of theology. Don't worry, Dick, I haven't forgotten, okay? Read a work of theology or pray. And then follow whatever desire you have that will lead you into an encounter with God. Sometimes it will be different. There will be times when you're praying where God will say, you know, like to me, sometimes He will say, journal now. I'm going to tell you some things to prayer journal. Do it now. Other times He'll say, dive into my word. Dive into that devotional book you've got there. Other times He'll say, stop, drop, pray. Sometimes I'll just go over to Alexa. You know Alexa's my friend, right? I go over to Alexa and I say, Alexa, play K-Love or play whatever, you know, just what, you know. I love We the Kingdom. Alexa, play We the Kingdom. She kind of, you know, shuffles it. So do whatever it is and don't feel like you've got to do it this way, this way, this way, this way. Let the Holy Spirit prompt you. Psalm 46 verse 10 says, God says, be still and know that I am God. Be still. We suburbanites have problems with that, don't we? We need to be still. We need to stop. We need to slow down. Be still and know that I am God. I will be exalted among the nations. I will be exalted in the earth. Let's go to step three. Step three. Essence of time. I don't want to keep you too long. Step number three, open your heart and simply receive the presence of God who already dwells within you. Open your heart and simply receive the presence of the God who already dwells within you. Ask the Holy Spirit to make His presence known to you. Now, God will do that in a number of ways. You do know God speaks, right? When we pray, it's not just us talking. God speaks, and He does it in a number of ways. And He'll do it differently for everybody. E.M. Bounds said that God will speak to you in a way that is familiar to you so that when He speaks, you know it's Him. Now, that's different for all of us. God has a way that He talks to me when I know it's exactly who He is and He's talking to me. For others of you, it will be something else. It'll be a thought that will come across the frontal lobe of your mind. It'll be a feeling that will dwell within you. But all of this has to match up with the written word of God, the 66 books of the Bible. It all matches up, right? So allow God to speak to you. Sometimes God will speak through somebody else to you, but you got to know what it is. So ask God to speak to you, to make His presence known to you. Take time to rest in an encounter with God's love and affection over you. Psalm 16, verse 11 says, you make known to me the path of life. You will fill me with joy in your presence and eternal pleasures at your right hand. In his book, The Furious Longing of God, Brennan Manning describes a method of prayer that has helped him greatly in learning what it is to enter into God's presence. He says to pray this simple prayer, Abba, which means father, or literally in Aramaic, it means daddy. Isn't that personal, right? He prays this prayer. Say, Abba, I belong to you. And then he says, as you inhale, pray the word Abba. And as you exhale, pray, I long to you. Can we try that? Except where the word Abba is, say father. Now, this may take some, you know, so I don't want anybody hyperventilating, okay? Right? So let's all inhale a big breath. You ready? Say,
Father, and then exhale and say, I belong to you. Do it again. Father, I belong to you. Again, Father, I belong to you. This idea of breathing and praying is an incredible depiction of what it is to receive the presence of God. It should be as natural as breathing. He is nearer to us than the very breath that fills our lungs, Brendan Manning writes, and he will respond to our desire to be filled with him. Then he closes by saying, may this practice of God's presence fill you with a greater awareness of how real and how near your God is to you today. I tell you all of that to tell you this. We can experience the presence of God. We can experience the presence of God. We can experience the closeness of God. We can experience the intimacy of God. We can experience the embrace of God. We can experience, yes, the very presence of God. Not just some of the time, but all of the time. And that is God's will. That is what God wants. That is what God has wanted for humanity from our creation in the Garden of Eden. That is why he sent Jesus to die on the cross and walk out of the grave. He wants to be with us. It's all about a relationship. It's all about a relationship. It's all about walking, and it's all about talking, and it's all about living out our destiny in constant, continual, powerful presence of God. And you can. Amen? Yeah. I thought you'd gone out the door on me. I didn't know. You can. We can, I can, we all can. Say this with me. Yes, we can. Give God some praise. Come on. That's what happens when we pray prayer number three. So what were they today that we learned? Prayer number one, a prayer for God's power to overcome our enemies. Prayer number two, a prayer for God's mercy upon others to bring them salvation. And prayer number three, a prayer for God's presence to empower us to live out our identity, carry out our ministry, and step into our destiny. These are but three prayers from the book of Exodus to inspire the way we pray. And I pray that we will all pray that way today. Would you give God some praise up in the house?
Come on, that message, so powerful. It's an amazing message with practical tools. Right now in the chat, give somebody a high five. Don't click off. I know you might think that service is over, but it's not. We still have some amazing information to share with you. We have one question for you today. You just heard an amazing sermon, so what are you gonna do about it? The first step is to give your life to Christ. If you've never given your life to Christ, why not today? You don't get it by watching us. You don't get it by rules or rituals. You get it by having a personal, real relationship with Christ. If you want that today, pray this with me right now. Jesus, come into my heart. I receive you as my Lord and Savior. God, I give you my life. I give you total control of my life. I believe you are who you say you are, and I believe everything the Bible said you did. And I ask you to come into my life. I know that I'm a sinner, and I ask for forgiveness today. I want to trust to follow you as my Lord and Savior. In Jesus Christ's name we pray, amen. If you pray that with me right now, God just came into your heart to live inside of you. I want you to go right now to cresthill.org/connect. This is means for a party. This is means for a celebration. So tell us about your decision that you just made by going to cresthill.org/connect. Don't wait. Go to cresthill.org/connect. There you'll be directed to our church's website, and then you can just click the blue button that says connect. Fill out some information about yourself so that we can celebrate with you today about what you just did. Don't wait. Hit the blue button that says connect today. Also, if you say, hey, I know about Jesus, but I want to find a church home, you can be a part of Cresthill's fellowship wherever you are across the globe. So go to cresthill.org/connect to be a part of our Cresthill family today. So lastly, did you like what you saw today? Have you thought, I would love to spread the message of Jesus across the globe? Then go to cresthill.org/give to do just that. Help us spread the message of Jesus across the globe. God bless you. I also want to invite you to come next week. Matter of fact, don't just come by yourself. Have a watch party with your friends so that all of you can praise God together. Come along with Cresthill next week. We know that your time is precious, so we want to thank you so much for joining us today. We don't take it for granted. You could be doing so many other things this Sunday, but you decided to spend it with Cresthill, so we thank you. So lastly, we love you. God loves you. Never give up, never give in. And as always, keep the faith.